one presence and one power in our lives. We ask God to come now and sit in our hearts, breathing in fresh, vibrant energy of the one God, the one energy of the universe. We draw our attention inward. And as we do, we visualize our higher self as a human-sized form of brilliant golden white light just over our head. Imagine yourself now slowly rising to merge with the light of your higher self. Your entire being transformed to brilliant golden white light. See this light growing larger and larger. And as it does, focus on your heart. Feel it within your heart beating, pulsing. And say to yourself, I care. I care. I care. Sit for the moment. The moment in time that is now. Feeling your light, connecting with each light in this place. I care. I care. Father, Mother, God, we leave the outer world behind as we welcome this moment of silence and sacredness. Being in present moment, and so it is. Now take a breath. And if you will, our opening affirmation is in your bulletin, in one of the little handouts. Opening affirmation.
I live in joyful awareness of God,
and I am a joyful expression of life. And so it is. And now I'd like to share with you the daily word for today, April 27th. I honor God's grace by expressing my unique gifts. Robert Browning wrote that there is an inmost center in us all, where truth abides in fullness. To know this inmost center, he said, we must open a way for the imprisoned splendor to escape. When my attention is focused outward, I may find that I compare myself to others or wish I was in some way different or better. When I turn inward, I see through the eyes of the divine and realize my innate wholeness and perfection. I embrace my unique combination of God-given gifts and acknowledge my heart's desire to express them. Uplifted and inspired, I joyfully share the richness of my divine inheritance with the world. And from Scripture, Peter 1, verses 4 through 10. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. And so it is. Now for our song of praise.
A song of praise. Would everyone open their hymnals to number 40. Fill me with thy presence, Lord.
Please stand and sing with us.
Thank you.
Some of you probably know Janis Stanfield and her signature song, big breakthrough song that is still well known, that she still performs all the time, If I Were Brave. Joni's going to sing that for us today.
If I were brave,
than what I did to be if I were brave. What would I not do today if I were brave? What would I not do today if I were brave? What would I not do today if I were brave? What would I not do today?
Since you've sang that song, if I were brave, I'd ask the children to come on down. The other brave part is getting down and getting up.
Hi, guys. Hi to everybody today. That was a beautiful song. You know, I was thinking about that song, and it says, if I were brave. Do you know that when we're brave, sometimes it's because we're scared and we still do things? That's part of being brave. But you know, you've been equipped with certain gifts to do things that only you can do. I know you can sing, and I know you can dance. Mm-hmm. I know you cook the best muffins. I know you love to act. You're perfect. And you just love coffee, I tell you. Now, all the other talents that you have were given to you by God. And those talents help you get through every day. You may be in a situation where it just doesn't feel comfortable. But if we stop and say, well, I know I have what I need to have to get through this. So all I need to do is remember. You know, some of us have gifts of singing, like Miss Joni. Some of us have gifts of playing music, like Mr. Duane. Some of us have talents of speaking, like Reverend Nate. Your moms, they have talents of cooking and getting things in order for you. So you have all sorts of unique gifts just for you. So sometimes when you get in that point where you think, I don't know if I can do this, just think, well, I have the gift within. I know I can do it. Believe in yourself, and it happens. Just like when you're dancing. You practice, and you know you can do it, right? Mm-hmm. So today, Miss Joni and I are going to see if we can help you bring out some of those other gifts. How about that? Is that going to be fun?
Yeah.
We'll get to talk about all that.
How about that? Can we do that?
All right, let's go.
Let's go.
We are walking in the light, in the light, in the light. We are walking in the light, in the light, in the light. In the light, in the light, in the light, in the light. In the light, in the light, in the light, in the light of God.
Our youth. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for them. And I'm sorry, but I got choked up. Anyway, hi, everybody.
Morning.
What a great weekend. And I will tell you, I'm so incredibly glad to be here in the physical because Thursday morning, I didn't know whether I was ever going to be able to get into my bedroom again. I happen to be one of these people that think there's a big S on my chest. And I, on a regular basis, get a call from the Kidney Foundation. And last couple of times I didn't have anything, but this time they called and I had the brilliant idea that I need to get rid of my treadmill so that I could make space for an elliptical, right? So I said, well, yes, sure, come by Friday morning and can they come in and get it? And they said, no, I'm afraid we can't allow our people to come into your home. It's going to have to put on a porch. I went, oh, no problem. I can do that. So most of you that don't know me don't know that the only male energy I have in my house is a four-legged kitty. So, but, you know, like I said, I have an S on my chest. So I thought, well, I can do this. I can do this. So Wednesday, I decided, well, I better start the process because I know it's going to take not just one try. So I go back into my bedroom, I fold the thing up, and I start to drag it and inch it and drag it and inch it. And I got it as far as the door of my bedroom. And I thought, oh, it's not going to fit through the door. That's okay. I'll wedge it and angle it and inch it, and all of a sudden it wouldn't move anymore. Totally wedged between my bedroom and the hallway. The cat was in the bedroom going, oh, I can't get out. Oh, I said, no, I can't get in. But I hadn't taken my shower yet. I was going, holy Jehoshaphat, what did I do? So I sat there and I thought, okay, just do what you do. Get calm. Take a breath. Oh, my God. Take a breath. What am I going to do? And I thought, well, you've got a toolbox. The only way this puppy is going to get moved now is if you dismantle it. Now, let me tell you, this is a 17-year-old device. And the nuts and bolts and gigas on there have been there for 17 years. And no matter how much I prayed over them, those nuts and bolts would not move with the wrench I had. So, okay, I called my mother. She's in Texas, but she's more practical than I. She says, did you call your brother? I went, oh, that's right, I have a brother that lives here. So I called my brother, and he has a construction company. He builds duct systems, you know. He knows his way around mechanical things. Unfortunately, he was swamped. I said, well, you know, I do have a handyman I know. Let me call him. He goes, he went, call him and I'll pay him whatever he needs. Just, you know, just call him. This is the way my brother always helps me. Hi, Rick, if you're watching this later. So anyway, he couldn't get here to my house until next Thursday. So I'm sitting here going, I need a shower before next Thursday. That's over a week away. So I finally get it to the point where I can go like this. I still have bruises, right? Go like this to at least get it in and out of the bedroom. So I can push it. Anytime I push it, the woodworking gives a little bit more and a little bit more. So I have to let it go. Now, those of you that know me a little while that you've known me know that I really don't let go very easily. I keep thinking of other ways I can do something. But I actually allowed myself to let it go and let God. Friday morning comes. And the kidney guys don't come, and I go take a shower. They're still not coming. I'm going, well, maybe they came while I was in the shower. Oh, well, they can't move it anyway, right? Now, this is where the doubting Rebecca comes in. About 30 minutes before I had to leave for my first wedding of the day, the doorbell rings, and, of course, it's the guy from the Kidney Foundation. And I said, well, I said, it's wedged back in the hallway, and I can't bring it out to you. Can you come in? He goes, well, we're not supposed to come in. And I said, please. And then I pulled the minister card. You see, I'm a reverend, and I have to be to a rehearsal in 30 minutes. He goes, oh, well, then may I have your permission to enter? And I said, why? Are you a vampire? Do you need one? I said, of course, come on in. Well, he looked at it, and I said, see, I said, Father, I'm probably going to get it taken apart. And he looked at me, he goes, stand back. He took it. Flipped it outside and just pulled it out. Front door. It was like, I spent how many hours in bruises trying to do it. And then, you know, I still have to be reminded, you let go and you let God. And God sends this big strapping guy to your front door that can flip however many pounds that thing was and out the door. And of course, I ran immediately to my wallet and got something for him to thank him. He goes, no, ma'am, I can't take that. This is my job. I said, that wasn't your job. And thank Jesus. And as I'm thanking him right now, and you were taking this little bit of gratitude in the way of green. So as I was preparing for today, realizing that sometimes if I get out of my own way, things are provided. And, you know, I look at Jesus as being the ultimate change agent. And so as I was sitting there saying, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, all of a sudden I thought, whoa, thank you, Jesus, for the opportunity to change my reality and remembering that I don't have to have the S on my chest. I can actually wait for the right person, the right timing, the right space to appear. And it's not, it doesn't have to be on my timing. And I know we know this, but when things like that happen, we panic. I panic. Yes?
Why is it always at the last minute? I'm sorry.
This is
the last minute.
It's always at the last minute. Why? Why is it at the last minute? It's the time. Now, and that was interesting because I had, after he left, I had 15 minutes to finish my makeup and get out the door, right? But it's okay because I think sometimes it's at the last minute, so we don't have time to, what's the word I'm looking for? I just went right out of my head. To second guess it. Exactly. We don't have time to say, what if, what if, what if. See, we let go and let God. That's why sometimes it's at the final minute. Because we've been blocking it so long, finally God says, take care of it. And it's like, if you just let go of it 30 minutes earlier, it would have been taken care of 30 minutes earlier. But we hold on to the control. We hold on to, I can do it, I can do it, I can do it. Instead of saying, I know we can do it. Partnership with God. Partnership with God. And I am such a control freak. I know I'm the only one in this room. Yep, I think that I had to tape that whole thing, so I started taping the whole thing because I was going to get it all done one day. Hello, tape, you're still there, and the painting still needs to be done because I'm Superwoman. And then I remember I have people in this wonderful family that can do the same thing I can do. I don't have to do it all by myself. So on May 17th, we're going to have a training day. And I'm not going to be able to be here because I got weddings. And you know what? That's okay. I don't guts to be here. Do I?
No.
See, that's what being, and see, I forgot to call, even think about calling my brother to help me. Because I always think I'm the big sister. I have to do everything myself. We forget we have a big brother named Jesus. And he says, don't worry about it. Have faith. Just like Easter morning when Thomas doubted. But Mary saw him. But at first, she doubted too. Didn't the Marys doubt? Because they thought it was a gardener walking through the garden. Couldn't possibly be Jesus. It was a gardener. And then all of a sudden they saw him. And how did they see him? They saw him in his glory body, didn't they? His light body. And they didn't recognize him because they were looking for something more mundane. When we are in our glory body, just like we did a few minutes ago, we offered ourselves to the light, and we breathed in the light, and we saw ourselves light, and we connected with everybody else's light. What that does is that raises our vibratory frequency so that we vibrate higher and higher and higher. And the more vibration we have and the higher we become, the more ethereal we do become. To the point where at some time we'll become so high in our vibratory frequency that some people won't be able to see us because we have merged into the light. And some people would think we disappeared. And what really has happened? There's a name for that in the Bible, isn't there? Beyond that.
Ascension.
Ascension. See, that's what Jesus was anchoring for us that day when he was walking through the garden. He was anchoring the ascension energy, that high vibratory frequency that we all have now as part of our reality. If I had remembered that on Thursday, I would have said, I release this because I know the form in earth time is going to be coming to my front door, literally, and taking care of this for me. Now I know it. See, I had to doubt it. I had to be Thomas. And then I had to release it because I couldn't do it. I couldn't roll that rock away from there. I had to wait for someone else to do it for me. We need to remember that we can say, I can't do this. I give it to you. Because I know you can. I know that it may not be the way I think it's going to be. I sat there and didn't even think about flipping it over on its side, which I couldn't have done anyway. But I didn't even think about that. I thought I had to take it apart. Destroy it. But it didn't have to be done that way. I mean, I was sitting there going, as I was watching him going out my front door with this just flipping it back on its side. Now, I know you guys are thinking, yeah, well, God would have known how to do that. God would have figured that out. Yeah, I know. I hear you. But, you know, it was just an interesting idea that I couldn't figure it out. And I usually can figure it out. As I look at what's going on right now, Tuesday is a new shift in energy coming in. Tuesday, and it starts actually today, remember that I have told you that there are two days before and 2 days after any kind of a full moon or a new moon. You're not going to turn that down.
I don't know.
2 days before, just saying, 2 days before and 2 days after a new moon or a full moon, we begin to feel the energy. We are going into the energy of the next sign in the zodiac, which is Taurus. Are there any Taurus people here? No Taurus? Oh, then we want to have a birthday cake next week. We don't have to then, right? Taurus is what? A bull. Right? You think of a bull. A little bit stubborn. But a lot of people don't realize that Taurus is actually also one of the signs in the zodiac that appreciates beauty. I dated two Tauruses in my life. And those guys appreciated me.
four of some of the best guys I ever had in my life. Let me just put it to you that way. They appreciated beauty because I have beautiful gifts in my house from them. And when I look at the archetypes, see, remember that in the Bible, we have 12 disciples, and each of those disciples have characteristics, but each of them also is related to a zodiacal sign. There are 12 of them. You know, these things are not an accident that are in the Bible. And there's also the seven thrones before God. And those are not only our seven chakras, but there are seven masters of wisdom. See, all of these have an esoteric wisdom behind them. And so that's what I like to share with you every month, what the astrological wisdom is, because we all have Taurus, as we know, in our charts. And there are 12 houses in our charts. And each of those houses is an energy that we live in at different times of our lives. So wherever Taurus is in your chart, this is the time, this is the month, to really allow yourself to use that energy. Does that make sense? Okay. So as we're looking at this new moon, which basically takes place on Tuesday, the 29th, at 2:14 a.m. It's also a solar eclipse. So the energy is a little bit more pronounced that we can use. It seems to be hidden, but I have, in my experience, solar eclipses are actually more powerful energy because it is hidden. It is inner directed, a lot of it, for me. We have somebody in the audience that knows a lot about this. And perhaps we'll convince her to do some workshops sometime. Hello, Dee. How are you? I use this book a lot it's called New Moon Astrology. And Jan Spiller really does a lot of great work with these ideas in here. It's a power day. So the new moon in the sign of Taurus is a powerful time for wishes. Now, remember, wishes are like affirmations. And so we can affirm the different things that Taurus has rulership over. First thing is money. It has rulership, George, over money. Your favorite affirmation, right? What is your affirmation? Share it with everybody. On money.
I love money.
There you go.
Money.
Loves me. Typical Taurian affirmation. Okay? Let's say it together. I love money, and money loves me. Now, look at what that is about, because a lot of times when I'm working with clients or students on this issue of abundance and money sometimes has a negative influence. They look at it like, oh, those people with all that money. There's some negativity sometimes in our relationship to the attitude of having money. Money is great. It's what people's attitude about it and what they do with it that contributes to the energy of what we feel about money. Money's a good thing. As long as we don't make it what? Our God. Now Jesus understood money. But he also understood that it was being abused by those so-called priests of the temple, the money changers. And John Calvin realized it with the Catholic Church. Whenever it becomes about money, it loses its power, it meaning situations, attitudes, jobs, right? And so when we look at Taurus, we also want to look at what is our relationship to not only money, but our job,
a new behavior. Taurus is really good at change. And that's why I brought the idea of Jesus as change agent. Jesus, when he came, didn't come to write the New Testament. He came to give testament to the fact that the Torah was being misused and abused and not understood. He did not go around with his iPad and start to write a New Testament. He was giving us the next step in what our ability was to manifest a new idea of God as love, not God as the Old Testament God. It was time for us to know that God is love, not God is vengeance, not an eye for an eye, but reap what we sow. Different energy there. A whole different energy. Because what that reaping what we sow is about is living in present time, living in love, living in service, but also Jesus understood that change sometimes has to be shattered apart and the tables turned over. What does that do in our lives? When we see that the same thing is happening over and over and we don't want it to happen, we have got to shatter it apart and turn the tables. Turn the tables. If they need to be upside down, if they need to be broken apart. And that's what we are going through right now, not only as this church, not only as humanity, but as a whole cycle of evolution. And we are being charged to do that. Look at where in your life you have become stagnant. Look in where at your life your treadmill has become wedged. And you think you can't move it. Does it need to be dismantled or does it need to be flipped on its side? Or do you need to ask for help to do either one? A lot of us think we have to do it ourselves. And we don't. Turn next to the person next to you. Say, would you help me if I were in need? You're in front of me. Say, did anyone say no? Give me their names. No. You know, I've talked about this before, that there was a wise teacher a long time ago that said, the quickest path to enlightenment is through service. Would you deny that person next to you their service? Of course not. Do you want to be denied your service? No. Let me help. Let me bake you a cake. Let me do this. Let me do that. And then you can do it too. It doesn't have to be an equal measure. It can be what you are best at doing. I make great muffins. I can't move a treadmill. I'd like to talk. I can't move a treadmill. So this is the time, too, in Taurus, to look at what are we good at. Jesus had two different missions that he showed up. One was his fiery mission, the change agent, the throwing of the money changers out of the temple. And the other one was softer. The other one was love. He actually epitomized for us the water mysteries, which is about cleansing the emotions, bringing in love, being soft, and the fire mysteries, which is about passion and change and transformation. We, each of us, have two parts, two sides. It's a part of our duality. God is light and dark. And now I'm going to ask you to stretch yourself a little bit more when I talk about the darkness of God. Because it's all God. Remember, everything is God. And so when we have the test and it's last minute, we think, remember that part of God in us, in order to change sometimes, is a challenge, is the desert, the temptation. What was the temptation that I had when I did the treadmill thing? But they all, I didn't get that part, thank you. Part of it was, I can do anything I can set myself out to do. I always have. But that was something that I shouldn't have tried. And that was also what Jesus was trying to teach us. If it's not yours to do, you don't have to do it. He had something to do, though, and he even at the last minute said, do I really got it? I think he probably just got his parental silence until he said, oh, yeah, I know I did it. Yeah, that's right. I don't think God tells us to do something that's going to really hurt. I don't think God tells us to move something that they really couldn't possibly move. That was what? That was my ego. And sometimes our ego says, I can't. And sometimes our ego says, I can. And that's really hard to figure that out sometimes. The only way I know how to listen to those two different dichotomous voices within us is to pray and meditate on a regular basis. One time, two times, three times a day. Remember that the initiates were instructed to pray 5 times. What were those 5 times?
Sunrise.
Sunrise. 12 o'clock. 3 o'clock. 5 o'clock. And just before bed, sunset. Of course, just before bed slash sunset used to be before electricity, so. But think about this. If you put yourself in posture 5 times a day and say, come God and sit in my heart, just go into the silence and just allow yourself to feel the presence of God within you 5 times a day. Do you think that's going to change you? Do you think your ability to hear is going to be heightened?
Yes.
5 times a day. Now, in the sacred science of numerology, 5 has to do with change. Wherever you see 5s, it's about change. 5 times a day. See, I love to look at the Bible. And then look at the esoterics of what has been embedded in there for those that have eyes to see and ears to hear. And not just the literal stuff, but the esoteric understanding of what Jesus gave in the upper room. They did not climb stairs. They went within and higher in their consciousness into the upper room so that they could understand what was behind the words.
Yes.
That is what the idea of the Last Supper and the resurrection and the fact that he did this for us, the historical Christ did this for us, so that we could have the energy to do it for ourselves. Except to move a treadmill. Anyway, so what are we going to do for the new moon of Taurus? Let me give you some ideas of some of, see, I use this a lot. Let me give you some of the ideas of affirmations. For money, material comforts, ownership, possessions. Now, one thing I don't agree with this book, it says, I want to. We don't believe in saying I want, do we? I am. And so what I'm going to say here is, I am now easily finding myself creating financial independence in a happy way. Let's repeat that. I am now easily finding myself creating financial independence in a happy way. And so it is. The other part of Taurus has to do with your physical senses, including massage. I'm getting massage on Friday. Massage, physical comfort, tastes, aromas. We're doing a wonderful workshop under the sign of Taurus that talks about learning how to enjoy these things. What was Jesus' first miracle? Wine. Do you think it was sour? Do you think it was like the best thing they ever tasted? Right? When Jesus did something like that miracle, it was to the best that anybody could have ever wanted. That's our legacy. That's our legacy. Taurus rules enjoyment of life on earth, including appreciation, gratitude, rapport with nature, satisfaction, my favorite, contentment. I am now counting my blessings and feeling thankful for the good things that are in my life with me. I am now counting my blessings and feeling thankful for the good things that are in my life. And so it is. Taurus has to do with reliability, patience, dependability, trustworthiness, steadfastness. It also has to do with the throat. The throat, the chin, and the neck. Your voice and your vocal cords. Let's see if there's a good one here that I like. Ah! I am now attracting right information that leads to a total healthy healing of my tendency to blank. What would you like to transform that has to do with your third chakra, with your throat chakra? Now, this is the power of the word. This is the highest power of creativity, and the word became flesh. This is our manifestation mechanism. So what are you creating by the power of your word that you would like to release and let go and transform? Think about that for a minute. Our words. Now, the issue with a lot of this stuff, and I want to give you a caveat here, is don't get so caught up in what you say that you negate the energy behind it. Let me explain this. A lot of times, those of us that are new thought, new age, will go out and say, oh, don't say that. What can we do instead? Instead of correcting somebody. See, because that puts people into shame and blame. Right? So, what would we do instead of correcting somebody when they say something that's a little bit, maybe not the best and highest they could be saying? How could we do that? We could say, you know, another way of saying that would be, don't say it that way, because that's shame and blame. Say, you know, we could also think about it this way, you know, because I know for me, okay, I'm half Italian. Sometimes I can get a little negative. We are very emotional sometimes, at least I am. And I can feel that the weight of the world is very heavy on my left shoulder, especially. And so what I try to do, and I say try, because it is a process. We cannot become spiritually enlightened in a day. We cannot necessarily become spiritually enlightened in a lifetime. Look at what Master Jesus did. His soul path, Now, there's an idea that Jesus himself was Adam. Have you ever heard of this? That he was Adam. His soul. Remember, resurrection, reincarnation, we take off a personality or a body. We go back into the light, and then we manifest again with, in partnership with God, another personality and body to continue our soul journey. So if he was Adam, when it was time for us as humanity to get the next step in our evolution, to get the next step in our spiritual progression, which was love, Jesus prepared a body over lifetimes and lifetimes that was high enough in its vibratory frequency that it could carry the peace of God that was love so that we could all have it. So when it was time that God said, they need you now, he said, I'm ready. I'm ready. And he went down and said, I'm doing this. And then he got down into the physical plane and he kind of forgot from time to time that he was God. Until some relative of his named John reminded him and opened the portal, if you want to use that term, for the Christ consciousness to be anchored into the physical plane for 3 years of teaching and uplifting humanity. That is the wonder of Easter, the wonder of this time of year, the wonder of each astrological sign that gives us the opportunity to hold that aspect of God. This month, it's the aspect of God that is reflected through Taurus. It's all God. 12 pieces of God that are shown down through us at different times of the year. So, my beautiful, beautiful people, the soul that is within you has a piece of Taurus that is going to blossom and bring forward this month. Appreciating money, appreciating chocolate, appreciating the beauty that is you. Where do you point when you point to yourself? The beauty that is you. Namaste.